Previously on Anything Goes.
We can say all we like, Kathleen.
I just want someone to hold me.
When I came in, you were crying in a corner.
Eating ice cream out of a bucket.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Now, but you before we even started the show, we were talking, you made a very loud point about...
I did. Women in comedy?
But just the idea that men do comedy to get laid.
Yes,
I want that point out there, because it's a very interesting point.
My thing about comedy is it's generally comedy is I believe the impulse to do comedy is a masculine impulse.
Yes.
I don't think that has to do with gender or anything, but I think the impulse to make people laugh is a masculine thing, regardless of whether you have XY chromosomes or XX chromosomes or even something in between.
Well, I think men are constantly trying to climb a status ladder, and if you can be the funniest guy in the room or the smartest guy or the richest guy
or the fastest or the strongest.
See, this is why I think that's right, because men... they're not attracted to a funny girl. They're attracted to tits and ass and a hot body. Women are usually attracted to, when you ask most women, sense of humor is one of the number one things they're attracted to. So a guy has to develop this really cool, fun guy personality, and he'll get laid more. A girl needs to exercise and not eat and vomit, and guys will hit on her more. And I understand, and I know Dave's gonna come in and say, no, I like bigger girls too.
But
or then he's cut out the vomiting part.
It is the norm of society.
Or bring it on.
Guys don't look at a girl and think, God, she's going to have a great personality. I want to fuck that personality. No, they go, I want to titty fuck her gigantic tits.
Well, okay. Correct.
You can't argue that.
No, I'm not about to. It's a losing argument.
But that's the way society is.
And now, let's get to a new exciting show.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Are you ready for some laughs? Are you?
Don't touch that dial. It was molested, and it brings back horrible memories. This is Anything Goes with Darren Frost.
How the fuck am I funny?
Dave Martin.
What have we got here? A fucking comedian.
And Kathleen McGee.
And I'll execute every motherfucking last one of you.
Can you dig it?
Does your dog play outside, Darren?
Yeah.
And do you, like, throw snowballs at him and stuff? And
no, she just loves to run around and bite anything that's wood. So, like, anything that's sticking out of the ground, she's just gnawing. She's still a puppy, so she's losing her teeth and getting new teeth. So she just wants to bite everything.
Did you see that? Oh, fucking shit. Did you see that photo on the internet?
I did not see that fucking shit. No, I did not see fucking shit.
Oh, okay. Well, it's not worth it. I almost knocked something over, and I didn't. did that photo on the internet about the baby's a child's skull? Did you see that photo?
No.
Because all the teeth, all the adult teeth are up here, and the baby teeth are here.
Okay.
And I mean, you know, logically, if you thought about it long enough, you'd be like, well, that makes total sense.
Right.
But when you actually see a kid's skull that hasn't lost any teeth, it is a very weird thing to look at.
But where do you think the teeth come from?
Yeah, I know. It's a thing you don't even need to.
Like the tooth fairy comes, takes the baby tooth and shoves in the adult tooth.
Well, like I said, it's like you if you think about it, it makes sense.
Sure.
That's how it is. But when you actually see it, you know, it's.
You know, when you first said baby skull, I didn't think you were going to talk about teeth, Dave. I don't mean to project. or thought what you were going to go with. But
I think you are projecting. I think you are.
How much did the tooth fairy give you when you were a kid?
Oh, Jesus. I don't know.
A quarter? You know? Yeah.
Yeah, like a quarter. Or I think there were loonies when I was a kid. But, like, my nephew got, like, $20 a tooth.
What?
Yeah, like, kids are getting, like, a ridiculous amount of money for their teeth. Like, their mouth is worth $500.
That just sounds like a great way to make money as a kid.
So my youngest, who's 11, still obviously believes, I got to say it's quieter, and he had lost two teeth in a row, so we gave him $5 for that, but that's only because it was two in a row. Otherwise, it's either $1 or $2. Most times, it's $1.
My tooth fairy things were all crushed when I was I went through some of my mom's jewelry boxes, and I opened this one, and it was filled with baby teeth. And I brought it to her, and I was like, whose teeth are these? And she was like, ah, the tooth fairy just wanted me to hold them for her. I'm like, why? And then she explained that the tooth fairy wasn't real. Right. And then she was a tooth fairy. But I also did swallow a tooth once. Like, I was playing with it, and popped out, and then I swallowed it, and then I got all upset, because I'm like, now I'm never going to get money from the tooth fairy. Mm-hmm. So we wrote her a note and explained what happened. And then the next morning I woke up and there was like fairy like sparkles all over my pillow. And she left a note saying she understood and she gave me money anyway. Like, this is the stuff fairies have to do.
The tooth fairy didn't treat you like a drug mule and just say, wait until you shit it out.
Yeah.
Let's see. Come on. You just can't throw that out there. I'm like, ooh, yeah. I swallowed a tooth.
Yeah, you're going to have to dig through your shit, little kid.
Yeah, shit in the bathtub and mush it up with your foot until you get something solid.
Now we're talking about Dave's childhood. This is good.
Or my drug mule days, but yeah. Let's not get on about that.
Speaking of childhood, Dave, you told me before we talked to Kathleen that this year you finally saw Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, the Gene Wilder version, not Charlie, the Johnny Depp version.
Yeah, no, not the Tim Burton version. Actually, it was Christmas Eve.
For the first ever?
Yeah, first time ever. And I had no idea that song, The Candyman, yes, came from that movie.
Yes.
I always thought it was just a Sammy Davis Jr. song that he adopted as his own. But yeah, I didn't know that it was from that movie. I watched the whole thing. I thought it was really great, but it's weird to see the remake before the original.
Right.
And then follow along like that with it. But
so I've never seen the remake or the reboot. They call it a reboot, not a remake.
Yeah,
very good.
But I love Willy Wonka. Now, not a lot of people know this, that Roald Dahl hated the film. Roald Dahl, the writer, hated the film. Hated the movie so much that he refused to make any more movies of his books for a very long time. And I think the next one that was made was finally when Tim Burton came along and did James and the Giant Peach. The family kind of entrusted him because of Frankenweenie and The Nightmare Before Christmas, knew that he would do justice to the text, and therefore let him do it. And James and the Giant Peach is a great movie as well.
Aren't they making The Witches? Isn't that coming out right now?
It is, supposedly, yes.
Yeah.
Well, they're all going to premiere on HBO On Demand, and you have to pay $30 for them to watch. But yeah.
So have you watched Soul yet?
I watched like 15 minutes of it with my son, and then I had to go because my dog did something. But I do want to watch it again. I've heard all the reviews, and lots of people are saying it's amazing.
We're talking about Wonder Woman, right?
No, Soul.
Oh, okay.
Watch it by yourself if you don't want your kids to see you cry hard. Because I cried so hard watching that movie. It's just like a very, it's like, every adult needs to watch that movie. It's a very adult Pixar movie. It deals with death and everything like that. Yeah. But it is like, it deals with like people who, you know, just like living. It basically, the message is you need to live your life. Whatever your life is, you need to live it. Like, don't like hold yourself back because you didn't get this or didn't get that. You need to actually live in the moment. And oh my God, yeesh, it was a good, I bawled my friggin' eyes out. It was such a good movie.
Well, I mean, I cried at Talladega Nights, so at the end of the first Transformers movie, so I'm not one to. But I mean, I think I might have wept at the beginning of the Up movie.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, you're heartless if you don't at least shed a little tear at the first 10 minutes.
And Wall-E is a great movie as well, and there's some heartbreaking moments in that movie.
Even The Good Dinosaur, which they say was a bad movie, like it tanked. It was still, my kids loved it. Now, I thought it was a good movie too. I don't know of a single Pixar movie that I've seen that isn't good.
Everybody keeps saying that it's like, because people are saying, well, Wall-E was really emotional and so was Up. But everybody is saying that this is probably one of the best Pixar movies of all time. Like, it's just done so well. The story is, and it's not like, there's no bad guy really in it. There's just like, I don't know how to explain it without ruining it. But it's not scary. It's just a great explanation of life, which is like, you know, everyone's like, what do we, why are we here? It's a very good explanation of why we are here.
Isn't Jamie Foxx the lead?
Yeah, he plays the
right, because I watched it for 10, 15 minutes, like I said, and I can tell you, because I do a lot of cartoons, he does a really, really good job in that movie, because it took me a while to really go, is that Jamie Foxx? Just, it's kind of, at least the first 15 minutes, very kind of understated. It's not like wild and wacky. It's very much a good character, and I was quite surprised.
Well, yeah, it was really good.
Yeah, I'm never a big fan when they promote the voice before the story,
right?
And the characters. I mean, that just seemed like a big thing with like Shrek and a lot of other animated films. It'd be like, hey, it's Eddie Murphy and Mike Myers, and
right,
you know, and I mean that's why I always really liked The Incredibles, because I mean they were really good, solid voices, and they did great jobs at it, but it wasn't like, hey,
well, the Incredibles is different, because the Incredibles, they weren't like big name. I'm not saying they weren't well-known actors, but they weren't like, yeah, but she's not like Jamie Foxx. She's not like at the moment the biggest star on the planet. They're stars and they're well-known, but they're not known to being stars. They're known to being good actors or actresses.
They're known to me. They're known to me. Yes.
But they're you know, that's the thing about that movie, The Incredibles. The first one, it's pretty much a kitchen sink drama.
Yeah.
When you really boil it down, it's a classic story, and I love that movie. It's still great.
Right. Did Kathleen, did you think that Die Hard was a Christmas movie? Because that's argument that a lot of people have.
I mean, if you're going to get real literal about it, it was an action movie. It wasn't a Christmas movie, but it was an action movie set at Christmas time.
Yeah. Right. I mean, that's the thing that always everyone says. It takes place at Christmas, and that's,
to me, is Santa and the idea of Christmas a huge part of that movie?
Like,
no. It just...
No.
Go ahead.
Well, I kept on watching it. Sorry. I keep cutting it down. But I watched it with Adam, who'd seen it a million times. Mm-hmm. And then I kept on like asking questions, and he'd be like, oh, that's going to come up soon. But I was like, why is this guy not wearing shoes? And then it all came together. And then I was like, you know, I thought Hans Gruber was not that bad a guy.
Whoa, g'day mateys. This is Bushwhacker Luke, and you're listening to Anything Goes with Darren Frost and Laugh Attack on XM Radio. Whoa!
And your audio is connected.
This is the basement, it looks like.
There we go. We can hear it. We can see you.
What was that? It's huge.
We can hear you. We, as a me.
Yes.
Nicely done.
All right. Hi, guys.
Can I ask you just quickly, do you have to put the lotion in the basket down there, or...
I'm in my RV. I thought it would be suitable to actually sit in. I don't live here, but I thought it'd be kind of a fun little set.
Yeah, nice.
It's a good set. It's a very good set.
It keeps me away from my loud family as well. So,
nice.
So is your man cave your RV?
It's pretty much. It's turned into my man cave on wheels.
Actually, you know what? Because I saw some of the photos of you going across country,
mm-hmm.
and I was I was in awe of it, because really, that's kind of like my end goal is to just buy one of those vehicles, and because I don't think I've ever been happier before since the peak of my genuine happiness was like when I was going across the states, just driving from Toronto to Las Vegas. But just being in a car and then just knowing that, like, you're crossing through all these different states with their own, consent laws. But let me get beyond that. But with their own, like, food and culture and everything like that, and their own history to it and everything like that. I love that idea of driving cross country like that. Now, where did that come from?
Why did I get this thing?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Jen Baxter, you guys know her, obviously, but we've driven across the United States from Toronto to LA like 8 or 10 times over the years, you know, because we always had a dog and we always wanted to travel with her.
instead of, you know, dumping the dog off with friends or whatever. So we started out with a van, a conversion van, and then we've had three travel trailers throughout our time, a 1956, a 67, and a 66. So we still have one in the driveway, and we thought, okay, let's go somewhere. This lockdown, this COVID bullshit, we were just like, get us the fuck out of LA. I can't stand it. Let's go. And we decided to, we didn't want to pull, because the last time we pulled a trailer with our SUV, we completely cracked the transmission in two. So we're like, let's not do that again. Let's get a vintage RV, you know, something that's barely working.
Right.
So, and we always, you know, I always like the idea of being in the vehicle and then sleeping in the vehicle as opposed to getting out and opening another door. It's a totally different experience. Terrifying. Fully terrifying, especially when I first drove this thing home from San Diego in June. I bought this thing and I drove it from San Diego for 2 hours on the highway up the 5. And I was white knuckling it because the steering's all off. So I'm just driving like this the whole time. Terrifying. And it didn't really stop the whole way. We went to Atlanta and back. And the whole way I was, this is how you have to drive this.
Yeah. It reminded me a lot, too, of like the beginning of, you've seen Lost in America.
Of course, yeah. Great movie.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then just, was it, like the two of them were just, they, you know, they put all their money into this RV and then that's going to be their life.
Yep.
Yeah. And that's a great an RV movie. Like that's a genre. But I also remember did you ever see About Schmidt?
I did. Yeah. He did take an RV, didn't he? It wasn't super focused on that though, was it?
No, it wasn't. But there's one part in it where he pulls up into an RV sort of campsite.
Okay.
And there seemed to be a whole RV lifestyle.
Right. Yeah.
Definitely. You know, what's that?
I was just going to say, I don't know about like everybody else, but during COVID, I was very like, I think I'm going to do this now because there's no such thing as stand-up comedy anymore. So I was like coming up with new ideas of jobs. And then I found out about this, like these people that take old RVs and then completely renovate the inside and make them look nicer than most homes. So then I found this one RV for like $1,000 in Northern Alberta. And it was a 1988 Swinger of some sort. And I was like,
oh, she's paused there. Sometimes her internet gets screwed up.
I was so close to it, and I did it. But I was so close to it because I would have been amazing. Just like to renovate a Swinger. Because I've heard a lot of RVers are Swingers as well. Like, that's what I've heard.
Get close enough. But they were all very, they're all very friendly. The people that we talk to, I mean, I guess this is their lifestyle, but you'd know when you get into a place where you have some lifers there.
Yeah.
You know, people that are there for a month. I mean, I think there was one place that for 2 weeks, the guy could park his RV there for $27.
Right.
It's like some crazy rates. And you know, that was not a nice RV park that we were parked at.
Right.
But you know,
that's part of the adventure. That's part of the adventure. You stayed some nicer ones and some not so nice ones, and you just get to meet people.
You know, the only time we only boondocked one time. We stayed at RV parks the whole time. Like Jen was not comfortable just parking on the side of the road in any town and just, you know, getting out on the sidewalk. It didn't feel right. But when we were in Jackson Hole, this is the time that, I mean, I think you guys, Darren, I know you reached out when I had my breakdown, which I thought it was over. The whole trip was over at that point. But it was we went to Yellowstone National Park the previous day, tooling around the mountains there and feeling very free and saw the old, I was going to call it Old Yeller, but the old guys, what's it called?
Old Faithful.
Old Yeller.
The time that was. So we went there and then we got back to Jackson Hole and it was dark and there was no RV parks open. There was nothing. It was all booked up. So we ended up staying at this parking lot at an Albertsons. And I basically called the chief of police or the police department in Jackson Hole and said, hey, I'm going to boondock. Is that okay? I don't want to get towed because everyone was like, they'll tell you. I'm like, I called the police officer and they connected me to the person who patrols the area. And she said, yeah, I'll come by and check you out. make sure everything's okay. And we were the only ones in the parking lot that night. And about two things happened that was weird. One, 1:30 in the morning, I hear this car driving through the parking lot with like a loudspeaker, very similar to the RV incident in Tennessee that happened. Like, you know, they had a loudspeaker going.
Yeah.
Had this loudspeaker going, and they had all I could hear at the blaring was, "It's the bare necessities."
Big Roger Miller fan.
Yeah. It was just disturbing. And then the next morning, we woke up and said, "Oh, let's just go to drive to Starbucks right around the corner." I'm like, get out of the driveway. I'm like, "Oh, I'll just turn around." Literally drove 50 yards, pulled into a Jehovah's Witness parking lot. And as I was pulling in, the whole front end just went boom and crashed right down into the cement. And it really honestly felt like the whole axle split in two. And, you know, I don't know anything about vehicles. And it was a ball joint. It was $400. And I got it fixed the next day. So it was a blessing in a lot of weird ways, but I really thought it was over with.
I wonder how it would have been if I mean, you pulled into the Jehovah's Witness parking lot, you got out of your RV, and I wonder what they would have thought if you went up and knocked on their door.
Right.
Help! I have some literature for you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You come out with your RV manual or something. RVing always sounds like it reminds me of like the state of Florida. It's like where it's like something that people do or somewhere where people go when they want to. They're either on the run from the law or they need to start a new life, like Alaska. It's like like that sort of thing of just like the idea that someone has no more address. And they're just on the road forever.
Well, I mean, the movie Into the Wild, that's a big arc in that movie is the RVing people who are kind of running from something, not willing to address it, and they're just living on the road in these RV-type places you're talking about. Yeah.
And then they die alone in their RV.
Yeah.
That's cool to me.
I nearly died in the RV a few times, so I was glad to keep my family safe, and so was my wife. You know, it wasn't safe. There was a lot of things that could have gone wrong. It wasn't safe to drive. And especially, you know, when you have like a transport truck just barreling right past you, the wind, it's amazing thing because as soon as it comes up behind you, you get sucked in at first and then you get pushed out and then you sucked back in. It's death defying.
Yeah. And Mike, you've seen the movie, The Hills Have Eyes.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah. Okay. That movie could throw someone off of RVing forever.
Now, there were only a few places that were like that, but I was never afraid of the people. You know, that was never the situation. And you know what? Anytime I ever broke down to within 1 minute, there was always someone.
Right.
It was like right there going, "Hey, do you need help? Do you need gas? What do you need?"
Yeah.
I ran out of gas twice on the journey, like middle of the road. I'm like filling up with my little gas tanks and everyone was right there to help. Police too. Like it was really fascinating how willing people were to help you out. And especially even when I broke down, my friends from you guys from Toronto and people were just reaching out and it was really heartwarming. Because I didn't feel alone, you know? And you could feel very alone when you're driving across the United States. Even if you're with your family, it's very isolating. And
Now it's been a few months since you've been back, right? Yeah. How long has it been back? How long has it been?
Well, I mean, I got back in the end of August.
Right.
So it's a good month and a half.
Right. So enough time has gone by. Would you do it again? Or are you like, that's my thing. I did it and that's enough.
I have to do it again. Okay. There was a reason behind this madness.
Okay.
The reason was that COVID-19 pretty much rendered everybody pretty useless.
Right.
And you know, like yourselves, I'm a creator first, and I'm not going to just sit there and write all the whole time and going, I wrote a script that no one will read. I decided to do kind of, you know, what I've done all my life is just sort of make my own shit. So
right.
We're shooting a feature film with my wife and my son, and that's what we were doing. That's the reason why I bought this damn thing. I would have bought a newer one that was running a lot better, but this one looks cool.
Yeah.
So we didn't have a script when we left. We were kind of doing things on the fly. I had good audio, but you know, no, nothing else. Like just nothing. Just
right.
Our talent and my drive And my son, I had to, you know, pull him to do it and drag him into scenes and like, just act and say this line and go, everybody act, act. It was really fucking tough. And it's still tough. And we're still finishing the photography of it all. But, you know, when I got home, I actually wrote the script and I'm very happy with the whole arc of the whole story. And it just takes time when you got no money.
Yeah.
To do it, like no investors, nothing. And I'm not asking people, I'm not going on GoFundMe going, hey, give me some money. It's like, if you don't have a good story, I mean, you're lost. But I have a good story and I don't have the means to make it amazing. I don't have the means to make it look like a Hollywood movie, that's for sure.
Right.
I can make it engaging. I can make it something that people will watch because it's representative of this time.
One of the things that I posted a couple days ago, and we'll get into Cooper's camera Christmas, but one of the things that I always respected about you guys, the Bob Room crew and you and Jason, is that, you know, a lot of people, especially in that era, talked about doing something, but you guys pulled it off at least twice with Ham and Cheese and then Cooper's Camera. Yeah. You had your ideas. You're like, fuck this. We're going to do it. However we got to get it done, we're going to get it done. And it kind of parlays into what you're talking about now. Instead of waiting around, right. It's like been always your MO. And one of my memories, and I think Dave was at this party as well, but the first ever Canadian Comedy Awards I was at. And my favorite showbiz story, one of them still is, that I was outside, I hadn't even gone in yet, and I think you and Jason were already outside, completely hammered, bragging to me that you've already been kicked out, and you haven't even gotten your award yet, and you were going to be getting an award. But that's how much I loved it, that you were so not taking it that serious, that this is supposed to be showbiz fun party, like this is the comedy network, right. A party for comedy, and you're getting kicked out and people are pissed off about it. I personally thought that was fucking hysterical. And then I'd heard you guys were doing, you know, other things, Ham and Cheese and Cooper. And I'm like, you know, great. Because this is what, in my opinion, at the time, comedy needed. And good for it. That's all I wanted to say, because I really felt that back then.
Thank you. Don't heckle Ron James. That's the message. Do not.
Why did you get kicked out? Why did you?
I was heckling Ron James. What the fuck?
What did you
I was
say?
Like, giving
what
him
did...
a hard time. Yeah. I was wasted. And then I got in I'm not a fist fight because I was like 5 feet taller than him, but Tim Progosh and I were like face to face yelling at each other. Later on, years down the road, the man buys me a dinner. You know what I mean? So
yeah.
It kind of, everything kind of comes out in the wash. And we were all so young and dumb and full of piss and vinegar back then. I mean, fearless and dicks too. You know, you when you're young like that, and there's a lot of confidence, there's a lot of ego. Over the years, you just sort of, all that sort of just drips off. Like there's no ego anymore. It's just, I just want to survive and enjoy this life with my family. Is literally, there's no fame. There's no like, I want to be a star. Like, come on.
Well, I know as someone who was at that party that, I think they took everybody up to the venue at the CTV like head office or the big studio that they had. They took everybody up in school buses, I remember. And
season two. This sounds like the second award show. This is
no, I think the second
award at Temple.
No, the second award show I think was at the second awards was at the Masonic Temple, but the first one was at the CTV headquarters, like their studios up.
I know that, yep.
Yeah, I remember that one because I left on the school bus and Andrew Clark was sitting in front of me and I proceeded to drink and throw beer cans at the window.
That's the way to do it. That's comedy, man. That's
well,
comedy.
I also, and then I remember, the second year one, because someone at head office thought, wouldn't it be hilarious if we got a bunch of twins? Because this is the second anniversary.
The idea is that they cocked up. I mean, the executives that run Canadian comedy, are they still there? Are they still working it?
Oh, yeah. You fail upwards in Canada.
Upwards. I really do.
Yeah.
I think that's when you get the best, the funniest stuff is when you are finally, you've seen the Hollywood machine and how it works. And you're like, this is so stupid. And you either give up or you make your own shit.
Right.
Well, I'm really, honestly, I'm on that tightrope right now. I mean, I just wish, I've asked, I said, please just tell me, give me some other career that I could do to support my family and live right. this life. And like, literally, I'm just like open-minded, waiting, and nothing. Like, I don't have any other skill sets, you know? This is what I do, and I'm a stronger creator than I am an actor. I've always just been a more geared towards that, but you know, it doesn't pay every single day. You know, you gotta grind through it. You gotta survive. Obviously, I'm talking preaching to the choir here, but you just gotta keep persevering.
Now this is the present we've all been waiting for.
I hope it's what I think it is.
Huh?
Oh, wicked, a video camera. Look how small it is too.
And we're gonna tape the best Christmas ever, right? With me giving out presents to Marcus, one up to Mommy.
I think it's time you learn the truth about Santa. He don't always bring you what you want. He can't afford it.
Christmas is here, children will cheer.
Happy.
Hey,
uh-oh.
Aren't
they?
Holy smokes. Someone popped a baby boner for his cousin.
Oh, look, I'm in the movies.
Oh, hello. Hello.
Here we go. You want to throw us off?
Oh, Mary, Mary. No, there's no way I was dying.
I'd kill you.
Who the hell's gonna watch this?
Oh, language.
Yeah, you don't want to piss off God on his baby boy's birthday.
So how did Cooper's camera come about? I mean, you guys did ham and cheese, right?
Yeah.
So you guys did ham and cheese, and then was this something you wrote afterwards for Cooper's camera Christmas, or you guys kind of had that one ready to go once ham and cheese was done?
Well, let's just say first that you and Jason Jones,
yes,
wrote ham and cheese, and you started it, and ham and cheese was sort of like a story of like a. How would you describe it? Because there's you, and then there's the sort of even more, are you equally delusional Jason Jones?
I was semi-retarded, and Jason was just this blind idiot who just didn't know what he was doing, who thought he was funny. My character was based off of, you know, sketch. We were basically doing our sketch characters that we did on stage, and we're like, hey, let's do a movie with it.
Right. Well, what was great about Jason was that he was completely clueless, just remarkably had no self-awareness, and but like remarkably confident.
Yeah.
And my favorite scene in Ham and Cheese is when he goes to the audition, and then he purposely forgets his briefcase in the audition.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
he has to go back into the room and do that sort of like, oh, hi there, guys.
Right.
I couldn't believe that just another chance for you to interact with the casting people. And I think every guy that has ever auditioned thought, before seeing that movie, but just thought, oh, that would be a great idea, because then they'll see my personality.
Right.
And then that'll win them over. Then I'll get the part.
Yeah. Well, that's just how you think, Dave. I've never done it.
I related to that scene so fucking much.
Constantly leaving your briefcase in auditions, are you, Dave?
Yeah, constantly. Yeah. A briefcase or a liquor store bag or knapsack or one of those two.
Exactly. Well, you know, with some like Ham and Cheese was very low budget again, just shooting it on the fly. I think the first day we filmed the entire day at Marineland, which is a place I used to work at. And we were sitting there holding the boom. Meanwhile, it wasn't recording a single bit of dialogue the whole day. Like, it was the first day, it was like, this is a disaster. We don't know what we're doing. We didn't have sticks. We had a pole that the DOP would just be holding like this. And then about 2 weeks later, I'm like, oh, did you need sticks? I have sticks at my home. Like, we didn't have the wherewithal to buy sticks. Like, that's how cheap it was. So, I mean, we just, again, full of piss and vinegar. Let's just shoot something. kind of cobbled together was hoop dreams for actors is what, or bad actors is kind of what we conceived that as. And we worked on that for, you know, just picking away at it like 6 months, not even like thinking that we're ever going to make it, just like, oh, let's put that funny scene into a movie. Let's put that in that script. So that actor's script, you know, and then that's what it kind of came out. But Cooper's was written very quickly. Like that was written less than 2 weeks over the phone, which Jason and I wrote. I mean, we've written like 10 scripts together, and like two of them, but most of them were written over the phone.
Right.
How much was scripted and how much was improvised? Because it felt so like very real. Like it didn't feel scripted.
100% scripted.
That's crazy because it was so good.
Little bits in here, like, you know, adding, you know, giving the scene some weight or some sort of filling out the holes, but it was all scripted. That was also a very cheap film. I think it was $100,000 or $70,000 of actual shooting budget. But where that first came from, we went to Banff one year and we pitched some terrible show idea. And it was embarrassing and it was a waste of time. And I was very much in the same vein as I was, Darren, when I was at the Canadian Comedy Awards.
Right.
I didn't care. It was like so pretentious. And we just were just, this is dumb. And we saw some Comedy Network people and we're like, we have this idea of this family doing this Christmas morning. And we based it off my family's videotapes. I have old VHS tapes. I watched it and it was, I mean, they're very similar to what the movie is, but without real humor, just more boring home video type thing. But the same scenes were kind of there.
Right.
And we watched that and we kind of pitched like that. Like, yeah, let's develop it. We're great. So we wrote like as a series. So we wrote a half hour script, which was Christmas. And then we wrote episode 2, which was the family going on a family vacation to a B&B. And we presented it. And nothing came of it, you know the way it goes. Nothing came of it. And when we're on set to shoot Cooper's Christmas or Cooper's camera then, and we're about to go to camera, the Comedy Network's lawyers contacted our producer and said, you can't film a second until you pay back the development money we gave you. So we had to pay out of our pockets, Jason and I's pockets, we had to pay before we started filming. So that movie cost me a lot of money to make.
Right.
I didn't make a cent.
Right.
But it was, you know, it was a labor of love and, you know, we had high hopes for it. But, you know, it's Canadian. And then it got to TIFF and had really great reception there, too. I mean, I remember being at the screenings and people were just like waves of laughter. I'm like, this is going to be great.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't. It was just, it just went away.
But I just discovered it this year. Like, I don't think that it's like, it just, I had no idea. And I love Prime because you just go through it and there's all these obscure movies. But I think it's just that like not enough people have heard about, I've told everyone I know this year to watch that movie because it's just so funny. Your character is like one of my uncles. Like your character is my fiance's favorite. Like he died. Like he,
right.
But I think that movie is just like, it's going, it might be one of those movies that like takes a few years, but it'll, I think it could become bigger. Like, you know, like a FUBAR style kind of like,
well, out of nowhere. I got to say, when it comes to your character, I think everybody either knows someone like that or is someone like that.
Yeah.
And, I think I'm still a quarter of that guy.
Right. Well, I'm at least 50% that guy, you know. I even got a little bit of a mullet going again.
Well, I think people want to see, because that movie was so politically incorrect in parts of it. And I think a lot of people are getting sick of how woke everything is. So if people start watching this movie, they're going to be like, no, this would not really fly, but this is what people were like in the 80s. Like, this is what some people are like still now.
Yeah.
It could be. I mean, I watched it the other night too, and I knew that we were going to be doing this. I'm like, I haven't watched this movie in about 7 years. And I was, you know, and you look at it through the 2020 lens of this wokeism that's happening, and you're like, there's a lot of rape jokes in this. I can't say that word anymore. But, you know, a part of me is like, what you're saying is like, who gives a fuck? I just want to throw it in their face. I want to shove it down their throat. You know, the way you throw up cunt bombs, I'm like, yes, yes, keep saying it, you know? Right. Like, you have to. And if people get offended, well, fuck them. I don't
Also, you always have that loophole as that it's a great, it's like it's, I mean, that almost is a genre now, too, of like found footage movies.
Sure.
So you got a great found footage movie of both you guys at Christmas and the whole Dave Foley part. And it's like, if anyone gets offended, you can just say, I'm being genuinely accurate about the 1980s. And this is how, and I don't think that, like, you know, it's like, if you watch a movie like Teen Wolf, they throw the word fag around, like it's nobody's business.
Oh, yeah.
And you're like, holy shit. How was this a thing that you could just do and get away with? And nobody cared. And was just like,
it's like we said before, Revenge of the Nerds. The one girl was so drunk, she thought she fucked the other guy. And in 16 Candles, the same thing happens. You know, she's so drunk, she thinks she's fucking the hot guy. That was that era of that decade.
Well, and
Revenge of the Nerds is absolutely should be banned. They set up cameras to spy on those girls.
Yes.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Right, and then
your mouth drops.
No, that and my other, what you know, what is now, they do a thing in Revenge of the Nerds, which would be now considered revenge porn, and you could go to federal prison for it because they set up the cameras in the girls' sorority. They take photos of them, and then at the pie eating contest, they put those photos at the bottom of the pies, and so when everybody finishes eating the pie, then they see the naked photos of these like sorority sisters. And they're like, oh, ha, 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 isn't this funny? You're naked and we're all laughing at it. And isn't this funny? And then, like, that's now revenge porn. And amazing. You can go to fucking prison for it. It's just
Dave, you know way too much about that movie. That's all I'm trying to say.
I've seen it. Weird. I've seen it at least in the last 2 years.
I always wanted to do a remake.
I just truly think that we're in a new cycle.
What's that?
We're in a cycle?
I think we're in a new cycle. I think people are sick of woke culture. People are sick of cancel culture. I think you can't cancel people anymore because everybody's being canceled 8 times a day. So yeah. I think we're going to see a new cycle of, like, let's get back to offensive, like, but honest stuff.
Well, you know, if that happens, I'll have a career. Because I don't really know how to not.
Yeah, good. I want it to happen.
This is why.
Well,
this
I think it's bullshit you don't have a career.
I have to keep a low profile on social media because, you know, I'm kind of like you guys. I'll burn the fucking barn down.
Oh, and
people will kill me. So I just keep my mouth shut and post pictures of my family every now and then and like something here and there. And
That's been my MO for the last 5 years.
Right.
But you know what? I live in Barrie where life goes to die. I'm having a family time. Right. That's it.
But you know what? Nothing's better than that in the sense of being with my boy and my wife. And the only reason I'm in Los Angeles still is because it's beautiful. But, you know, if I had a real desire to work and I gotta hustle, I mean, I could probably get some more shit going. But I can't take away this time that I've had watching my son grow up. It's been beautiful. Been there every single day for him. And this COVID thing was just sort of like a little pivot for us. Like, oh, yeah, it's kind of like every other day.
Yep.
Yeah.
We're prepared for it.
One thing I wanted to ask you about in the casting of Coopers, obviously you knew everyone in it, but there was a casting process, right? Because I know that Michael Stevenson said I'd liked my comment, and he also had made a comment about it was one of his favorite things to cast.
Right.
Michael Stevenson was a casting director for many, many years in Toronto. So how hard was that process for the movie? Because everyone pretty much, their characters were very much nailed. I mean, there wasn't one character where you were like, Peter Callahan comes across so schmarmy. And I know he's not a schmarmy guy, but he fucking comes across so schmarmy in that movie. It's great.
He's so great.
Oh, yeah. I just want to say one thing about Peter Callahan. It was like, one of his first movies was like this 1980s screwball comedy called Screwballs.
Yep, okay. Yep.
And it was a Canadian film. And I know Simon Rakoff and Howard Nemitz did Punch Up on it. But it's basically the premise is we want to see this girl's tits, and they conceive some crazy scheme to they're gonna put a metal magnetic bra on her and then have this gigantic metal magnetic sort of gun that they're gonna point and then her bra will rip off, and that's the whole goal of the movie, is let's see this woman's boobs. I remember Peter Callahan was walking up the street once around, that chicken wing place that all the Yuck Yucks comics used to go to. I don't know where Peter Callahan was going, but I said to him, I yelled out, I loved you in Screwballs. And he turned around and he actually said, some of my best work. And he kept walking. And I was just like, good for you. Good for you. But he was great. He was great in that movie.
Fantastic. You know, he really helped us in that regard. And that was obviously he didn't need to audition. We kind of knew he would be great. And, mm-hmm. you know, it's pretty good. It's pretty easy to kind of get Canadian actors, no matter what status, to work for $100 a day, you know?
Yep.
So it was good to get him. And, you know, all the other things was, you know, Stevenson, he's so great. He cast ham and cheese as well for nothing. I was kind of nervous about asking him to cast. Like, hey, Michael, would you mind, you know, doing this? I mean, I wasn't like huge buddy buddies with him. You know, I'd go for auditions, but I just respected him so much and liked him as a human. And he was like, yeah, no problem, no problem. And then he did it again. I hope someone paid him for the second time, but I know he didn't get anything for ham and cheese. But, you know, he brought up some great people and these, like, not even a lot. I don't think we saw many people. You know, it was like the kid who played Teddy was fantastic, Dylan. There was like maybe like five kids that we saw, and I was in LA. I saw them just on tape. You know, I'd watch their auditions and go, yeah, I like this kid. And everyone liked the same people. It was easy. Yeah. That little Dougie kid. I mean, I watched it the other night. The way he nails the camera with the orange on one take. I mean, certain things were just really worked out perfectly on that film, kind of lightning in a bottle in a lot of regards, because we didn't have a lot of time, shot it very quick, and just scenes came together, actors came together, and it just worked out. Jenny Parsons, oh, so great.
Yeah, very, very funny. How many days was the shoot? Do you remember?
Yeah, 14.
Wow.
Maybe. It was
lightning. Were you drunk during the snow, like the sledding?
No. No, I was just...
He's got to be...
I was
just all red.
I just knew that it was going to happen. And the original in the script we wrote it was, and I'm glad we had the wheelchair instead. But the original was a bicycle going down, and that was ice. That whole thing was ice. You know, you know the way it is to toboggan in Canada.
Oh yeah.
But it was originally supposed to be a 10-speed bicycle, shirt off, riding down. Which was very FUBAR in a way, so I'm glad we didn't do that. So it set it apart. But I was scared of that scene.
Oh man, when that happened, I actually turned to my wife and went, "Holy shit!" Because I know how these shoots are. There's no safety precautions. There's nothing. It's just like, let's see if it goes. Let's see what happens.
One take again. I wasn't gonna go up there and do that shit again. I had a huge welt on my side. But you know, it was fun as fuck. It was just a great time. You know, everyone was really determined to have a fun time, and that's credit to Warren having a great crew, and people it just worked out really nicely.
How did the Dave Foley element happen?
Dave's always been supportive of us, you know, back from the Riv days. So like, you know, whenever I talk to him at some drunken party or whatever, I'm like, yeah, why you in my movie? Ham and cheese. sure, I'll do it. And he did it. And then after he did ham and cheese, we stayed in touch. And he's like, yeah, I'll do whatever you guys want, you want.
Was so that his butt or was it a butt double?
That was all Dave, man. That guy.
Dave's butt.
Dave's dick, Dave's butt. I mean, it was kind of like, you want to do this? He's like, sure.
Well, yeah, you don't really have a budget for a stunt butt.
Yeah. Really, if you can't afford crash mats, you can't afford stunt butt.
I really enjoy that sort of found footage sort of genre. I think there's a lot of really cool movies out there in that style. I thought if you ever really wanted to trip someone out, that you could combine two found footage movies, and I would love to see a recut of Cooper's Christmas and Cloverfield. Just like two movies that are both, what the fuck is going on?
Right.
It's this family movie But then underneath that family movie is a movie about an alien fucking invasion, and just sort of like, it'd be more like just like, it would be a hilarious back and forth.
Exactly. I think Cloverfield came out like a good year or so before our movie, and it was a big inspiration of like, hey, let's just do a comedy version of Cloverfield, which in turn was also just, let's do a comedy version of Blair Witch Project. But that's funny that you mentioned that. That'd be very funny. Mixing the genres.
Well, yeah, really, of course, I mean, you wouldn't tell anybody that that's happening. Right. Or they would just be all surprised and like, what?
Well, it's a good twist. It's a good midpoint twist, you know, bringing the aliens at that point.
But I also want to make a point. I find it very interesting that in Coopers, both co-leads are married to their respected people in the movie.
Right. Well, I mean, it worked out that way. We didn't need to cast anybody for that.
Right.
You know, yeah, I mean, it just works out. I mean, if any time I'm ever, if during these times that I was in LA and I, you know, sell one of my shows or whatever, I get to that point, everyone I fucking know is going to work on this shit. You know, right. Why you do this stuff. You get that level of fame, you get that level of success. You don't go, well, fuck everyone I ever knew. It's more like, hey, come on in.
Right.
Use the connections. I hope that you now start your own thing. Like, it shouldn't be about that.
Yeah.
Well, that's also a driving force of my perseverance, is that I feel like I owe it to people in a lot of regards. So I'm still fucking trying. Still swinging, guys. Still swinging.
Well, I was curious about something. How did it go from Cooper's Camera to Cooper's Christmas?
Yeah.
Because that's the thing. Like, if you look it up on Prime, one's 14 plus, and then one's 18A.
Huh.
There's like, yeah, there's, and then one, and like the one that's 14 plus is like, or adult accompaniment, as they used to call it in Ontario. It has like an extra minute on it. So, I mean, if you go to Prime, at least in Canada, I just saw it for the first time, like a couple of days ago.
Right.
But it was like weird. It's like there's Cooper's Christmas and then Cooper's Christmas, and one. But moreover, anything else? How did it go from Camera to Christmas?
Well, I believe at some point, a couple years after it was made, and you know, it was obvious it was just gonna die in Canadian obscurity. The producer sold it to Anchor Bay.
Okay.
And Anchor Bay did something with Lionsgate. I don't know. Again, deals that I don't get anything for, but, and they decided to make it more marketable, which, I mean, in retrospect, it's like, yeah, that's a better name. Cooper's Christmas is a better title than Cooper's Camera, because what the fuck is Cooper's Camera? It was only called Cooper's Camera because it was never meant to be a Christmas thing. It was meant to be, that was the pilot.
An episode to this other thing, right.
So it was, that makes sense. So someone else made that executive decision, not us, did the whole sleeve of the DVD and all their pictures. And I'm like, didn't have a say in any of this stuff.
I mean, you know, when people shit on Christmas, I didn't mean to say that. When people shit on executives and producers and even critics, There are those moments when they're sort of like, oh, right, that's what you're for.
Right.
It's like, yeah, slap Christmas on it, and then boom, it's like a whole, I mean, because when I was looking for it, I went into Prime and I just typed Christmas, and you know, you have to scroll, but then you find it and you're like, oh, great, here's a Christmas movie we haven't seen, because we've seen It's a Wonderful Life or A Christmas Story or
And, you know, you can also see ham and cheese online now, too. There is there's an app called Canadian or something that you can pay $5 a month for, or you can get a 1 week trial free, and you can watch ham and cheese on there.
No, thanks.
Yeah.
I'm good.
Okay. All right. Okay.
I've seen it. I'm good. It's a little embarrassing at times. You know, you're just starting out. You're trying to make something, and you can't always be so proud of it. That said, I'm more proud of Cooper's.
Mm-hmm.
I feel more like, yeah, that was a funny fucking movie, and you know, it should be ranked up there as at least in a Christmas movie. It's like, yeah, that's one of the funniest Christmas movies. I mean, yes, what,
it really
I would
is.
Competition.
There's the thing is in comedies for Christmas. What is the competition really? You've got Elf.
I don't know.
And that's it.
Is that like,
but
for
there's
comedy?
No, like, there's no edgy, like Bad Santa. But like, there's no.
Oh yeah,
there's
Bad Santa.
Like, there's nothing that's like adult Christmas comedy,
yes.
And this is what it is. And I've told everybody. I found it just because I was looking.
Yeah, I mean, I've been pushing it all week as well.
What the fuck is this?
Yeah.
So, well, that's great.
I just think it's really
funny. Well, you know, I lent it to my neighbor. It said on, like, I think it was on the 23rd. My neighbor, who I see every day because we just walk our dogs. And I'm just getting to know him, like, because we just moved to this area. And I'm like, hey, you guys watching any movies? You want to watch a Christmas movie? And I gave him the movie, and he goes, that's how I found out it was on Prime. He's like, I found it on Prime. My mother-in-law's over, and yeah, we're going to watch it. It's the bed. And I hadn't seen it either. I hadn't seen it in 7 years. So I ended up watching it that night as well, going, oh, my God, they're watching this? And I saw them on Christmas Eve, and they're like, I'm like, so we saw Cooper's Christmas. Character was, wow.
Yeah,
all I have to do is shit on it. I have to go, yeah, you know, it didn't hold up. I know.
We were young. We didn't know.
Well, I always like that review of when it was like, hey, we saw it, and we saw it. You know, that's basically just you're acknowledging that you watched it. That's all.
You guys look like you had a lot of fun. A lot of fun. It's a carnival.
Did you have a time making that? Yeah.
You guys look like you had a lot of fun. Is the you look very confident on stage?
Yeah.
Movie making.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks, Mike. We want to just take this time. If you got anything you're working on outside of this, the RV movie, or is that pretty much your project that you got going on?
Well, I mean, look, there's not a lot going on. Right. You know, unless you're on a major Hollywood movie. I mean, I did have a movie that. I did book. I was going to be doing scenes with John Hader, and they're like, nah, because of the lockdown in LA, it's moving to Virginia.
Right.
I'm like, does that mean, what am I? You're going to hire local? Like, I don't even know where it's at, but it's been pushed to the summer. So it's like, okay. RV movie, Last American Vacation is pretty much my focus. And like, I got other projects that I've created, and I'm just waiting to hear. You know, you wait. It's constantly waiting for people to read it, and then go, "Yeah, this is great." And then you follow up 2 weeks later, going, "Hey, so what do you think?" We'll get back to you. And then 3 weeks go by, and then so many times it's just,
"Who are you?"
Yeah. Things fizzle, but we'll see what happens. But I'll keep you posted. I'll keep you posted. That'll be the only time I'll post on Facebook. I'm like, "Hey, look, I did something."
Hey, this is Nick Beaton. You're listening to Anything Goes with Darren Frost on XM Satellite Radio Laugh Attack.
It's always awkward when people are leaving the meeting.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I hate wrapping up because it's always weird to wrap up, but he's been on for like 45 minutes almost, so it's like that's...
Yeah.
Did you want to keep chatting, or are you good for tonight?
I think that's a good ending. You know, I think we're good.
All right. These were my magazines from the 80s that I recently found. That they're all high societies.
Oh, high society.
Yeah. Do you want that cheap horn?
Do you look at it with a monocle?
Yes, I do. In my top coat, when I'm riding my carriage.
Yeah.
And the
rickety bumpety, oh, that's great for jerking off to high society in the carriage.
I always loved, anyways. Is that really that pleasurable when a woman does that?
I don't know, Dave.
Okay. What is she doing? I can't tell.
Well, she's just doing this with her lips, and that seems...
No, that's not for women. That's not for women.
Yeah,
that's a pose for men.
Yeah, yeah. Even I kind of doubted that when I was a youngster.
Show me a pose in there that a woman would do. That's the better question.
Well,
there won't be one, Dave. You can come back next week and show it.
Okay. All right.
All right.
Well, I'm glad everybody had a wonderful and happy Christmas and all that.